It's no secret that color plays a crucial role in the way we experience art. Color informs what we pay attention to, how we feel about it, and how we interpret it in the context of its environment. So, wouldn't it suck if your carefully crafted color palette was ruined as soon as you tried to show your project on a different kind of screen? In the modern day, people watch videos on all kinds of different devices. From phones, to TVs, to theaters, there are so many different display formats out there to keep track of. And not only that, but most projects have to combine footage from different source formats shot on different cameras. So how then do we ensure that all of our viewers have the same experience, regardless of what device they watch on? How do we keep color consistent across multiple source formats and multiple display formats? The answer is the dark art of color management. In previous videos, I've discussed the basics of how color works in a digital environment. Every image has a gamma curve, which describes how linear light information is curved before being saved, and a color space, which defines the relationship between colors in a file and colors in the physical world. Together, a gamma and gamut tell us how to take real light and store it into a digital file, then how to take that file and turn it back into real light for us to view. There are many different combinations of gamma and gamut in use today, all designed for different use cases. A professional camera will often provide multiple gamma and gamut combinations to choose from when recording an image, and a display will typically have its own native gamma and gamut, which describes how its pixels will respond to a particular input. Now, we can convert one gamma-gamut format into a different one using something called a color space transform, but we need to be smart about which transforms we use and when. Let's say you're working on a large-scale feature film production. It's very likely that your source footage won't all have the same gamma and gamut. Some will be from different camera manufacturers, some will be computer-generated, and some might be archive footage from previous projects. All of these different source formats will need to look the same when mixed together. And on top of that, you'll likely need to deliver your movie to be displayed on different kinds of screens. And those screens won't all have the same gamma and gamut either. Movie theaters will need a different format from streaming services, which will need a different format from HDR TVs, and so on. Even if you know how to apply color space transforms to convert one format to another, it will still be a massive headache to ensure that the right transforms are applied in the right places and in the right way to keep everything consistent. So instead of keeping track of everything manually, most professional productions use color-managed workflows. Now, there are a number of different color management systems out there, and I'll discuss a few of them in detail later on. But generally speaking, this is how a typical color management system works. Every project has a timeline color space and a timeline gamma, which serves as the master format for the project. All of the editing, color correction, and compositing is done in this master timeline format. So once a timeline format is chosen, all of the source footage for the project undergoes what's called an input transform, which applies the appropriate color space transform to convert the source format into the timeline format. For example, it's common for input transforms to convert log footage into a non-log timeline format. With all the source footage converted to a consistent format, it can then be edited and manipulated however is needed. Then, once post-production is finished, the project undergoes an output transform, which converts the timeline format to one or multiple display formats for delivery. For example, output transforms can be used to generate multiple versions of a project, each designed to be shown on a different kind of screen. So that's a basic overview of how a typical color managed workflow works. But there's still a bit more to the story. See, within the umbrella of color management, there are two main kinds of workflows, display referred and scene referred. The core difference between these two is the choice of timeline format. A display referred workflow will use a display standard as its timeline format. So if your timeline is Rec 709, Rec 2020, or similar, then you're using a display referred workflow. Display-referred workflows are easy to understand, and it's very common for the timeline format and the output format to be one and the same. However, display-referred workflows are often subject to various forms of bias introduced by the choice of display standard. For example, if you choose to work in an SDR format like Rec 709, then you'll likely have lackluster results when trying to upconvert that to HDR. And the other way around, if you work in an HDR timeline, then an SDR downconversion might not look the way you want it to. Scene-referred workflows seek to solve this problem by working relative to the physical world instead of relative to a display standard. Scene-referred workflows typically use a linear gamma, since light in the physical world is linear, and they also often incorporate a very wide color space. In a scene-referred workflow, we don't necessarily care what kind of display our image is going to be shown on, and instead, we manipulate the colors as they would exist in the physical world. Scene-referred images are neither HDR nor SDR, and they can't be shown on a monitor directly. They simply seek to capture the light and color of an image with as little bias as possible. So, which is better? Well, it's a matter of personal opinion. Both scene-referred and display-referred workflows can produce great results, so I recommend experimenting with both to see which fits your production better. Now, let's go over some common color management systems in a bit more detail. First of all, I'm sorry to disappoint, but Adobe Premiere does not support true color management. While it does have a few rudimentary tools, I would not recommend trying to use Premiere for color management. Adobe After Effects does have a rudimentary color management system, but I won't be spending much time on it since After Effects isn't designed to function as a complete post-production solution. In this video, I'm primarily going to be focusing on color management in DaVinci Resolve, since it has the most robust and feature-rich color management system on the market right now. And bonus, you can even use color management in the free version, without restrictions, so that's nice. In fact, Resolve doesn't just have a complete color management system, it has two. Resolve Color Management, or RCM, offers a highly customizable workflow. It can be used for either display-referred or scene-referred workflows, and offers plenty of options for customizing the color management behavior for the specific needs of your project. The other system is called ACES. ACES isn't unique to Resolve, and is supported by a wide range of post-production programs. ACES doesn't offer the same degree of customization, because it's designed to be a consistent and standardized workflow for the whole filmmaking industry. ACES is always scene-referred, and it's primarily tailored to high-end workflows. Both systems produce great results, so I'm going to discuss both of them in detail, and you can decide for yourself which you prefer. Let's start with Resolve Color Management.
So here we are in DaVinci Resolve with a simple test project, and to enable Resolve Color Management, we're going to go ahead and go up into Project Settings here, and we're going to go down to Color Management, and so we're going to change the color science from DaVinci YRGB to DaVinci YRGB Color Manage, and this will enable RCM. Now, by default, it's just going to select a preset for us, in this case, SDR Rec 709. This is just going to preset all of the color management settings for us. We've got a couple different ones to choose from. But for the purposes of this video, I'm going to go ahead and select custom so we can reveal the more detailed settings. Now, there's a lot of stuff to look at here, but really there's only three settings that you really need to worry about and change. So the first thing we need to look at is the timeline color space here. Now, it's important that we select our timeline color space first because we don't want to have to change our timeline color space after we've already applied color correction. And the reason being, if you apply color correction relative to a particular gamma and gamut, and then you change the timeline color space, then the same correction is going to be applied relative to a different format, and that's going to lead to a distorted result. So we have to choose our timeline color space at the beginning of the project. And as you can see, we've got a lot of different options to choose from. Rec 709 is fine for a display-referred workflow. We can also go with a larger format like DCI P3, or we could choose to go with a scene-referred workflow and use a linear. And like I said before, a scene-referred workflow helps to eliminate the bias associated with a particular display standard, but it is a bit less intuitive to work with if you're unfamiliar with it. But for purposes of this project, I think I'm going to select DCI P3 as my timeline color space. It is important that your timeline color space is as large or larger than your largest delivery format. So for example, if I actually wanted to deliver DCIP3, I wouldn't want to select Rec 709 as my timeline color space, because then the output would be constrained by the small color gamut in the timeline. So if I want to deliver DCIP3, I need to make sure that my timeline color space is at least DCIP3 or larger, or say if I want to deliver Rec 2020, then it would need to be Rec 2020 or larger. So that's just something to keep in mind when selecting your timeline color space. It's generally better to select a larger one. It may be a bit less intuitive to work with since you're gonna be undergoing an output transform, but it will allow you to deliver higher end formats later down the line. So it sort of future proofs your project in that way. Now, the next thing we're going to take a look at is the input color space. Now, this right here is the format that it's going to assume all of our clips are in. So it's going to be converting from the input color space to the timeline color space. Now here we're just setting the default, but we can override this on a per clip basis. So for example, I know that these clips are not Rec 709. These clips were shot in S-Log 3. So to address that, I'm gonna go ahead and right click on these clips. We're gonna go to input color space and select S-Log 3. And this is going to override that default input transform, and you can select this individually per clip. And the other thing we want to take a look at is the output color space. So while all of the corrections will be done in the timeline color space behind the scenes, it's going to be transformed into the output color space whenever you look at it in the viewer or in the output through the deliver tab. So the default output color space is Rec 709, and I'm gonna leave it as is because that's what my monitor is. But for example, if my monitor was a DCIP3 color space, then I would select that as my output transform, and you can see that now the output is in DCIP3 instead of Rec 709. So again, I'm just gonna go ahead and put this back to Rec 709 because that's what my monitor is. And so now we can sort of see this workflow in action. Our source clips here are being taken from their source format, that is S-Log 3, and they're being converted into our timeline format, DCIP3. The color corrections are being applied relative to the timeline format, and then it's being transformed again into our output color space so that we can monitor it. So that's the basics of the Resolve color management workflow. And once we've set it up, we're free to grade the image however we want to. There aren't really any restrictions in that regard. Though keep in mind that the color grading controls might behave a bit differently than you're used to if you're used to working in Rec 709. So for example, in this case, my timeline color space is DCIP3. So all of my color corrections are being applied relative to P3. So they might behave a little bit differently than I'm used to, but fundamentally all of the controls still work. And then once we're done editing and we want to deliver our project, all we have to do is make sure that the correct output color space is selected for our delivery format. So in this case, I'm wanting to deliver Rec 709 for YouTube, so we can just leave that as is. And we can go to the deliver tab and export the project as normally. Now, if we want to deliver to multiple formats, all we need to do is render the project multiple times with different output transforms. So let's say I've already rendered my Rec 709 version, and now I want to render a DCIP3 version for a wide gamut display. All I have to do is go in and change my output transform to DCIP3. And as you can see, the output will change accordingly. And now I can export a DCIP3 version of my project. So that's really all there is to it.
Now let's talk about the other color management system available in Resolve, ACES. ACES is a system designed by the filmmaking industry with the goal of standardizing the color management workflow across multiple production companies. The purpose of color management is to maintain consistency. So if different production houses are using different color management solutions, they could easily encounter consistency issues when trying to share files back and forth. ACES also seeks to ensure that no color information is lost throughout the post-production process up until the final export. To achieve this, ACES defines several formats which are to be used at different stages of the production. For completeness's sake, I'm going to briefly go over each of the ACES formats, but it might get a bit dense, so if you're only here for the conceptual stuff, feel free to skip over this section. The main format used by ACES workflows is called ACES 2065-1. This is a scene-referred format, meaning it uses a linear gamma combined with float encoding for unlimited dynamic range. It also uses an extremely large color space called AP0, which encompasses every color in the visible spectrum, as well as a few outside of it. This format is designed to be able to contain any image, regardless of its dynamic range or gamut, without any loss of information. While ASUS does utilize several other formats that I'll discuss in a moment, ASUS 2065-1 serves as the master format, which bridges the gap between different programs and different phases of production. While ASUS 2065 is capable of storing any image we can throw at it, it isn't necessarily the most convenient timeline format for some portions of the workflow. To address this, ASUS also defines formats called ASUS CG, ASUS CC, and ASUS CCT. ASUS CG is designed to be used when creating graphics and visual effects. It uses a linear, scene-referred gamma like ASUS 2065, but it utilizes a smaller color gamut called AP1. To be clear, AP1 is still definitely a large color gamut, but it excludes extremely saturated colors, which a graphics artist isn't likely to use. Next, we have ASUS CC, which is meant to make the color correction process more familiar for experienced colorists. Most colorists are used to working relative to a logarithmic gamma, so working in ASUS 2065 would require adapting to an entirely different environment. ASUS CC addresses this issue by retaining the full AP0 color gamut, but using a more familiar log gamma curve instead of a linear one. There's also ASUS CCT, which is the same thing as ASUS CC, but with a slightly tweaked curve to make the shadows of the image easier to work with. Unless you have a specific reason to use ASUS CC, ASUS CCT is usually the better option. So that's the ASUS workflow. Source footage is converted to ASUS 2065, which can then be sent off to both visual effects artists and colorists. The visual effects is done in ASUS CG, and the color grading is done in ASUS CCT. And they're both converted back to ASUS 2065 and merged together. Finally, the completed project is sent through one or multiple output transforms to generate versions of the project which conform to various display standards.
So now let's take a look at how to use ASUS within Resolve. Once again, to get started, all I have to do is go up to Project Settings and Color Management, and this time we're going to change our color science to ASUS CCT. And this is going to switch us to an ASUS color managed workflow. And you'll notice that this time we don't have the option to select a timeline color space. And that's because ASUS chooses the timeline color space for us. It's a standardized workflow, so the timeline color space is always the same for everyone. But what we do get to change are the input and output transforms, just like before. So just like with the Resolve color management, we need to choose an input transform to tell Resolve how to transform our source footage into the timeline color space. And in this box here, we can select a default that will be applied to all of our clips. So in this case, I can choose Rec. 709, and Rec. 709 will be chosen as the default for all of our clips. So once again, we can choose to override that default input transform on a per clip basis. All I have to do is select our clips, right click, select ASUS input transform, and we can choose a different input transform for these particular clips. And notice that the output looks really weird, but don't worry, that's okay. It's just because we haven't assigned an output transform yet. So if we go back into Project Settings, we can choose an output transform based on our monitor, in this case, Rec. 709. And now you can see once again, we have a correct Rec. 709 image displayed in our viewer. Now, one thing you might want to do as part of the ASUS workflow is you might want to export the image in its plain ASUS 2065 form so you can use it in a different application like After Effects, for example. And to deliver the raw ASUS 2065 image, all we have to do is go back into Project Settings and disable our output transform. And now what we're seeing in the viewer is the plain ASUS 2065 image without any output transform. Now, one important thing to be aware of when rendering a plain ASUS 2065 image is that you can't use an ordinary codec like H.264 or ProRes or something like that. And the reason is that ASUS 2065 uses floating point encoding, meaning it isn't constrained to the ordinary 0 to 100 range. And we can see that here because a lot of these values are clipping because they're above 100 and we can't display them on our monitor like that. And if we were to render this image to an ordinary codec, then all of this clipping would be baked in and these highlights wouldn't be recoverable. So in order to correctly render an ASUS 2065 image, we need to use a format that also uses floating point encoding. So we need to go over to our format here and change from QuickTime to EXR. And this will generate an EXR image sequence that utilizes floating point encoding and can store the ASUS 2065 image correctly. So if we render this image without an output transform to EXR, then what we're getting is an ASUS 2065 image that we can import into any other ASUS compatible software. But let's say we're done with all of our editing and we want to render our image to a normal format that we could upload to social media or something. All we have to do is go back into project settings and put an output transform back on. So in this case, we select Rec 709, and now we have our Rec 709 output transform applied, and we can render it to an ordinary codec. So you only need to render it to EXR if you're trying to render the plain ASUS 2065 image without an output transform. If you do have an output transform applied, then you can render your image as normal. And just like Resolve Color Management, if we want to generate multiple versions of our project in different color spaces, all we have to do is render it multiple times with different output transforms. So for example, this version is Rec 709, and I could go ahead and render this. And then if I wanted a Rec 2020 HDR version, I could go into the output device transform and select Rec 2020 HDR. And now the output is Rec 2020 HDR. So just like Resolve Color Management, we can use ASUS to generate multiple versions of our project, each designed to be shown on a different kind of screen. This is why movies look the same at home as they do in the theater, even though TVs and theater screens use very different color spaces and gammas. Color management allows us to maintain consistent and accurate color regardless of how many types of cameras we use or how many different displays we need to deliver to. Even if you're only delivering in Rec 709 for social media, color management can still be a valuable tool for future-proofing your work and understanding how digital video really works under the hood. Anyways, I hope you all enjoyed this video. My name is Cayman Crocker, signing off.